Hey, yo, what up? Bubby Dead Sequential Geek. Welcome to my channel. Got some of that Marvel Milestone Edition goodness. These were printed the month 30 years after the original comic came out. It's like a 30th anniversary type of reprint that had this metallic sheen, some type of metallic silver-like paint. It made the paper stock quality a little bit firmer. And allowed it to have bends a lot more than your average comic. This one is a VF minus VF copy of Fantastic Four, issue number one. It's 2021, y'all, so that means it is the 60-year anniversary of both the Incredible Hulk and Fantastic Four. What's up, sir? So I paid $21 for this comic that includes shipping, and it is so difficult to get this comic in like near mint minus. I'm not seeing any color breaks, but I am seeing some serious dents. So yeah, that's the paper stock quality that they used for the 30-year anniversary. Saying no longer valid right there. Pointing out the ads. Careful. Put this back in the bag. Pause here. And for the two Incredible Hulk comics that I got right here, one of them I paid $12.58 total, and the other one I paid $29.39 total. Once again, these Marvel Milestone Edition comics, they're really sensitive spines. Type of material on the cover, that paper stock that just bends easily and shows easily any type of flaw. Yeah, 1962. That Fantastic Four came out originally in November 1961, so that Marvel Milestone came out in November 1991, and the Marvel Milestone reprint of Incredible Hulk came out in September 1992. And I looked on the inside. These are both first printings of Marvel Milestone Edition. The second printing of Marvel Milestone Edition has, it's just gray. I know this looks like a regular gray, but actually I opened it up. It does say first printing on the inside. And yeah, it's more of just a regular matted type of gray. That isn't this material that shows bends and dents real easy. So that would be called the third printing, which is really your second printing of Marvel Milestone. So I got all first printings here. So that's right, 60-year anniversary of the Fantastic Four. Co-plotted, co-created by Stan Lee and Jack Kirby. Same with the Avengers. Original print date is September 1993. Same as the X-Men. Their first printing came out in September 1993 as well. All of these co-plotted, co-created by Stan Lee and Jack Kirby. Script by Stan Lee. Artwork by Jack the King Kirby. This is Jack Kirby and Stan Lee. This is at the height of their game right here. Stan Lee and Jack Kirby. That was $18 for that Marvel Milestone Edition. Avengers number one reprint. So the prices of these Marvel Milestone Editions are going up for at least a VF price. You get these babies at least a VF under 10 bucks. I say grab them. Marvel Milestone Editions, I think, are your classic reprints. There are those little trade paperback, black and white reprints of Marvel that have come out throughout the decades. But I really think if you want to get like the first reprint of a Marvel comic in comic book form, at least in modern age comic book form, it's going to be your Marvel Milestone Editions. And to me, these are little gems in the rough. Get these babies in really nice VF plus or better condition. Definitely say buy them up. It's getting to the point where I'm starting to hoard these. I'm reaching three copies of each of these. I think I got with Fantastic Four, Incredible Hulk. And that's my third copy of Incredible Hulk. This is my second copy of Fantastic Four number one. It's my third copy or second copy of X-Men number one. My fourth copy of Avengers number one. Just getting multiple copies of these Marvel Milestone Editions. It's just getting to the point now with collecting where I've got everything on my bucket list pretty much checked off, except for like four or five comics. And now I'm getting into a little bit more hoarding, I guess you could call it. But it just gets to the point where you see these comics and you're like, why didn't I buy five copies of that? Why didn't I buy 10 copies of that? Some of these comics that are in the discount bins, especially like these Marvel Milestone Editions, not so much in the discount bins anymore, but you find them in good shape, you might not be able to flip them for three or four times the price, but you get multiple copies, you're definitely going to be able to flip something like a Marvel Milestone Edition, I think, for 30% what you paid, 30% extra. I mean, I think it's possible for something in this condition to be worth $50, a near mint VF plus copy of Marvel Milestone Edition. Yeah, these are sleepers. While everybody's paying attention to some of those key books at the moment, I'm getting really sick and tired of those top 10 lists, man. So many motherfucking top 10 lists out there, which is fine to cover, I guess, if you're going to do that on a weekly basis every once in a while. But Jesus fucking Christ, there are so many fucking top 10 lists out there. It's making YouTube, a lot of these YouTube channels that I've been following, so fucking stale. Damn, think of something else. There's like way too many top 10 lists out there. So I think there's a lot more runs of books that people can point out that still hold value, not necessarily in a flipping for a huge amount of money type of sense, but just great story, classic key book finds. And like I said, keeping an eye out too, not necessarily for top 10s, but just books that are rising in price. I look at a Marvel Milestone Edition, you get this in great shape. I don't think the price is ever going to go down in something like a VF or better condition of these Marvel Milestones. Everybody is learning how that metallic type of sheen material, that harder paper stock, that firmer paper stock, is harder to keep in good shape. Get yourself a nice copy of a Marvel Milestone Edition like this. But yeah, that Incredible Hulk 181 Marvel Milestone Edition and VF or better, seriously eluding me. I got two copies. I need that third. True Believers, Amazing Fantasy, number 15 reprint. Yeah, these books, you know, if you really look, you probably could still find this for $5. Now that there's no more conventions, the book is going up in price, y'all. This was one of the first True Believer comics that came out. I know that later, eventually, those True Believers got higher print run. Just proving that more people are interested in back issues than the current stuff anyway. True Believers, Amazing Fantasy 15, first appearance of Spider-Man, cover by Jack Kirby, script by Stan Lee, co-created, co-plotted by Stan Lee and the artist Steve Ditko. Yeah, this is This is a classic reprinting right here, and that True Believers print run, like I said, they started off low like anything else, and this is one of the first True Believer comics to come out. So they did this amazing fantasy reprint. It's really hard to get it, and VF or better. If you want to go up on the internets and brag that you got this baby for less than $5 and VF or better, please, please do. Yeah, they really milked that whole reprint wave when they not only did True Believers, but then they did their facsimile reprint, which really isn't a real facsimile reprint. Around 2005, 2006, when Marvel reprinted Fantastic Four number 52, that was a facsimile reprint. That was a real facsimile reprint. And you still have the barcode down there at the bottom. That's not a facsimile reprint. These are more of a facsimile reprint. I know that in the cover here, you got the border, but on the inside, it shows all the original ads. On the Incredible Hulk reprint, it does say, like, first printing. But then, like, for some of these other Marvel Milestone editions, I think, like, with Fantastic Four, it won't say, like, first printing for the Milestones. It'll just show the regular indicia, the regular copyright from when it originally came out. So, yeah, I know they did that. I'm not sure if it was with the Fantastic Four, but I know they did that with this X-Men number one. So, had to let it slide so I didn't bend it. It's still good. It's still safe. Okay, looking inside, we got X-Men published. Printed in the USA. Volume 1, number 1. Right there, September 1963. So it doesn't even say, I don't believe, I'm not seeing it offhand, that this was printed in 1993. I look at that, you know, when they show the original ads inside, and really, I'm not comfortable showing the inside of comics like this, but I feel like as a comic book reader and a collector, it helps to show. I mean, you gotta appreciate the history of it and what it is. I was just about to say, and if you train yourself to be careful, you can enjoy the contents of something like this comic right here. But I got a good deal on it. I paid under $10 for that one nice copy of Marvel Milestone Edition, X-Men number one reprint. So we got Happy Anniversary 2, Incredible Hulk. Or no, Hulk came out in 1962, so Happy Anniversary to just Fantastic Four number one. Stan Lee and Jack Kirby. All right, for $19.69, I bought Ultimates out of 2002-2003, issue number 1, number 9, 10, 11, 12, and 13. Six comics I paid $20 for. Two of those six were the newsstand editions. Now, if you find the Ultimates Volume 1 by Mark Millar and Brian Hitch, you find issue number 2 in newsstand, let me know. Just let me know, okay? Because I'm trying to build up newsstand copies of those new Marvel era comics. It's like NU, MARVEL. It's like an unofficial name of this era around 1999, 2000, till around 2003, 2004, where you had this combination of Dan Buckley, he was running publishing, and Bill Jamas was president, Quesada, editor-in-chief. They were each doing these revamps, modernizing Marvel character-based assets. And although people say that the Nick Fury, the Samuel Jackson Nick Fury's first appearance was something like Marvel Team-Up, number 6, I think. That's bullshit. I think maybe the African-American Nick Fury was in that those issues, but the likeness of Samuel Jackson... Yeah, the likeness of Samuel Jackson wasn't used until the Ultimates issue number 2, regardless of what anybody wants to say about Marvel Team-Up number 5 or 6, whichever one that is, Ultimate Marvel Team-Up, I think it's number 6. The likeness of Samuel Jackson was first used in the Ultimates issue number 2. So you see that in a newsstand, you let me know. Because that is extremely hard to find. Newsstand editions of these new Marvel era comics. Yeah, they're really difficult to get. Because obviously if you look at like Mile High Comics website where they give the rundown of newsstand edition comics. Super low print run. I don't know, 5% or some shit. Year 2000, 5% newsstand, 95% direct. By 2005, 2% newsstand. It's that new Marvel era. So as you know, the print run and that early 2000s era, I definitely recommend checking out collecting comics that are in that new Marvel era around 2000 till around 2004, give or take a year. Some classic stuff and a lot of modernizations of classic heroes that were going on. I think today people would just glance over comics like the Ultimates. They were a huge deal when they came out. Kind of take it from that perspective. If you ever get a chance to see the animated movies, they did a couple of animated movies that were based on these comics. The second one takes place in Wakanda. There's a 2-disc DVD set. The second one with the extras has interviews with Mark Millar and Brian Hitch. They did describe how they were using Samuel Jackson without his permission, using his likeness without his permission, and just how they were modernizing these superheroes, giving them a new look, a more practical take on the concept of a costume. They were making some comments about how for decades these superheroes looked like they were naked men with colors spray painted on their bodies, and how they wanted to modernize their look to be more utilitarian, materials from sports clothing and military gear they wanted to incorporate, which I think they did a stellar job, and it's one of the comics that got me back into reading spinning comics on the reg. That lasted up until around 2006, 2007, but yeah, it was a good solid 5-6 years of comic buying. Now my bucket list is, like I said, I got like 4 or 5 comics left that I'm looking for, but now it's at the point where if I see anything from that new Marvel era, from like the Ultimates, X-Force, in newsstand. Yo, buy them up. These are timeless, classic takes on some new gods, 21st century. It's going to take over people's minds, taking over people's spending habits. Just got this in on the internet. Speaking of that, new Marvel era. Guess what's inside here? The first comic to drop the comic book code authority under Marvel. Officially. That's right. I saw a deal I couldn't refuse online. Newsstand copies. How much did I spend? For X-Force issues, 117, 118, 119, 120, 121, 122, 123, and 124. For 8 issues, I spent a total of $26.57. Let's open this up. So those new Marvel comics, they got a super low print run. You know, they're significant because this is the era when Marvel was turning things around. A lot of the concepts that were being created, published in that new Marvel era were concepts that were being used as the framework for the Marvel Cinematic Universe as we know it today, pretty much. All the new stuff that's going to be coming out on Disney Plus. It's all that new ideas, new wave, but I'm talking about the new Marvel and new Marvel, that unofficial era. First appearance right here of this time-traveling reality show host. She's not a reality show host. She covers like tabloids, kind of like a TMZ host on TV, cable, internet, whatever. She is, her name eludes me, Lacuna. First appearance of Lacuna. Newsstand. X-Men number 121. 2 copies of X-Force 120. This is the issue where we learn a little bit more about Dupe's background. Of course, he's got history with Wolverine. Issue number 118. So the Peter Milligan, Mike Allred run started with issue number 116. And here's issue number 117. Looks like they got them packaged them. 2-in-1 comic. Hey, as long as they're in good shape, I don't care. Hella glare hitting up out there. All right, let's see if we can get this going here. We got some serious glare issues. But nonetheless, the reason I think that X-Force is such a great investment is because it's this modernized take on superheroes, on mutants, on just comics, on big two comic publishing. These guys aren't all about just biff, bang, pow, superhero fighting. It's just a more realistic take on life, I think, in general, especially people in their 20s. X-Force, they shifted gears in issue number 116. They went away from the Cable, New Mutants type of team to this reality show group of self-centered, get-rich-quick, looking for a way out of the daily grind type of heroes, I guess you could call it. They go on missions, superhero-type missions, but that's all set up by the producers of the television show that they're all members of. Reality TV characters on. They're trying to play an image. They're playing themselves to a certain extent like that, but it's not written that serious. And I really dig X-Force for that aspect of just like that more realistic take of how there's people out there that are just out for themselves. And that with Allred's artwork, Peter Milligan's writing with that whole narcissistic reality show, not really trying to be a superhero take on these Marvel characters. Once again, just like with the Ultimates, it was a new modern take on these decade-old run of superheroes that so desperately needed some rejuvenation, some modernization in the art and in the way the stories were being told, and stuff like Ultimates and Peter Milligan and Allred's X-Force brought that to the table. They brought that on a regular basis, on a monthly basis, to the comic book shop. Once again, that brought me back into reading comics. My original phase of reading comics was like 1979 to 1989. And, you know, things got old quick by around 86, by Secret War II. So, you know, I opted out for a good 10, 11 years. And definitely by like 2001, I was back in again. So the newsstand edition, as you can tell, it's got this more narrow barcode symbol right there. The direct edition, I love it. I don't have a direct edition comic to find right away. The direct edition, it's going to have this thicker barcode at the end, and then you've got like 001, the first three, it's the issue number. And then those last two, the second to last is the cover. So if that last two digits was 21, that would be cover B. And then the last number is printing, first printing. So with this narrow barcode symbol right here, more narrower, that's the newsstand. And then also with issue 116, you know it's the newsstand because here it'll say 116 and then that other section of the letter M there, that'll be a hashtag symbol. The regular direct edition would have 116 here, and then it would say, "Hey, kids, look, no code." That's right. X-Force issue 116 was the first Marvel comic to officially drop the Comics Code Authority. As of issue 116 of X-Force, Marvel no longer was trying to print comics under the auspices of the Comics Code Authority. Cover date, July 2001, was X-Force 116. That X-Force 120 right there is cover date, November 1st, 2001. So, yeah. So, for $26.57, I got a newsstand edition of X-Force 117. Number 118. Number 120. There's 119. 120. 121. 122. 23. That's the Enough Said. During around that time of 2002, this was in February 2002, Marvel was releasing these Enough Said issues for each of their titles. Silent issues. This is the silent issue of X-Force, number 123, newsstand. And this is a really nice Darwin Cook cover, X-Force issue 124. So yeah, man, 117, 118, 119, newsstand, 120, that's right, two copies of 120, featuring Wolverine, saying what's up to Duke, 121, 122, newsstand, 123. Nice. You Go Girl drawing by Darwin Cook. Alright, in my last haul, not my last haul, but one of my previous videos, I was trying to order a copy of Marvel Milestones edition. That's Marvel Milestones with an S. A copy of Black Panther reprint, issue number 26, and they sent me the direct edition, and eventually I found myself the newsstand copy of this really nice Sal Velluto cover. Christopher Priest comic book. Here we go. Black Panther, issue number 26. Sal Velluto artwork right there. Now, as you can see, that says Stones with the S. Marvel Milestones. We had the Marvel Milestone reprints that were in the early 90s. Reprinting issues that came out 30 years after the same month of their release. Then, around 2005, 2006, we had the Marvel Milestones reprints. And that's a reprint of Black Panther, issue number 26. There's a Kazar reprint in there as well, but I'm not interested in Kazar. I'm interested in this real badass picture right there. Real cool picture of Storm and Black Panther. $37.79. Telling ya, these Marvel Milestones, Marvel Milestone, True Believer comics of key books like Amazing Fantasy 15 reprint. This is one of the first True Believer printings. That Amazing Fantasy 15 low print run. This is Off the Cave Wall. This is a Tundra Press up and coming previews type of comic book. And I couldn't turn this one down. I got this for $15. That includes shipping. It's like 14 something. And it's really beautiful condition. And it's a reprinting of the cover of Tundra. Tundra Press's The Crow Volume 3. So, yeah, this is Tundra titles shipping in May. I know that the previous issue of this Off the Cave Wall, on the back, this is the front cover, that's why I got this one. The James O'Barr artwork right there. This is James O'Barr, 1991. You know, the history with the Crow is kind of elusive. You know, people trying to figure out when the Crow was first printed, and I know I can tell you real quick offhand how Caliber Presents number 1 came out in January, cover date 1989, and Dead World is a horror anthology comic book, and it was originally printed by Arrow Comics, and the first 9 issues were printed by Arrow Comics, and then issue number 10 was published by Caliber Comics. What I'm getting at is that although the Crow's first appearance is in Caliber Presents issue number 1, cover date January 1989, Tim Vigil cover, by the way. That Caliber Presents only has an 8-page story of the Crow. It's the first appearance of the Crow by James O'Barr, written and drawn. But on the back cover of Dead World number 10, there is an advertisement that takes up the entire back cover. And that, you could say, is the first appearance of the Crow cameo, advertising appearance, call it what you will. But that is the Crow first time it was in print on the back cover of Dead World, issue number 10, cover date November 1988. Dead World, when Caliber Comics took over, created 2 different covers. A regular cover that was by Vince Locke, and then a Not for Wussies cover, a B cover, so to speak, one of the first B covers, November 1988. That cover was done by James O'Barr under the pen name Johnny Zero. It's a portrait of King Zombie, one of the anti-heroes, so to speak, or just, you know, whatever, one of the monsters out of the Dead World Horror Comics anthology. So yeah, man, Dead World issue number 10, the back cover's got an image, a whole page advertisement of the Crow by James O'Barr. It's a unique drawing, it's not like it's a reprint. And the first appearance of the Crow is out of Caliber Presents number 1, January 1989. And then Caliber, they started printing the Crow stories, the 4-issue limited series of the Crow by James O'Barr, as of February, cover date, 1989. Now, Tundra Comics, they reprinted in 3 volumes the Crow story. So Caliber Comics had a 4-issue limited series of the Crow. Well, the first 2 issues of that were combined under Tundra, and Tundra has a 3-volume set of the Crow. The first volume reprints the first 2 issues of the 4-issue limited series of The Crow, originally printed by Caliber Press. The issues 3 and 4 of that Crow issue limited series by Caliber Press were reprinted in Tundra's The Crow volume number 2 of Tundra. Now, Tundra Press's The Crow volume 3. It's a 3-volume set under Tundra. That completes the Crow story. There was a 5th issue that never got printed. There was a preview for the 5th issue in Caliber Presents issue number 15 by James O'Barr. But the 5th issue got printed as the 3rd volume of Tundra Press's The Crow. It's just the final volume. It's a 3-volume set. Volume 1, which was subtitled Pain and Fear, came out January 1992. And then under Tundra, The Crow Volume 2, subtitled Irony and Despair, that was a reprint of Caliber Comics The Crow issues 3 and 4. And then that 5th issue of The Crow finally got printed under The Crow, Volume 3, subtitled Death, written and drawn by James O'Barr. And that 3rd volume, printed by Tundra, subtitled Death of The Crow, just the 5th issue, so to speak, an oversized 5th issue, uses this cover. That's my story. And then after Tundra printed that 3-volume set of the Crow stories, issues 1 through 5, that oversized 5th issue being printed for the first time in the Crow volume 3, Kitchen Sink Press came out with the Crow trade paperback in 1994 that was not simply a reprinting of the Crow stories. It did have extra individual stories. So if you're a big Crow fan, you want that Kitchen Sink printing of The Crow which is a trade paperback that came out in 1994. Don't you know it? Yep, yep. All right, so thanks for watching so far. I'm just going to wrap this up with... with a Wizard comic right here. I got this for free, basically. I spent, including shipping, $6 on this comic, but then they advertised it as very fine near mint. I wanted to get this because, you know, just like I always say, invest in what you know, collect what you like. And that second era of my collecting, from like 2000 to around 2005, 2006, it's huge for me because of the changes that were going on with this new Marvel era, like with Frank Quitely and Grant Morrison's new X-Men. To me, that was overdue. That was what I wanted by the late 80s. And they instead, Marvel vouched for their spec bubbles and gimmicks, and things got drawn out quality and story-wise until around 2001. And then, you know, they set themselves up for their buyout. That Heroes, Gambit, brand identity thing they were doing just before Alonzo took over. It was lame. So, this is a really cool X-Men special by Wizard Comics. As you can see, there's some water damage right there, so I was expecting just to mail this back. They actually just gave me a full refund. I was going to give this away, but then when I looked at the centerfold, I thought that the centerfold was just going to be a spread of the whole X-Men team. You know, hopefully some type of Frank Quitely drawing. I figured that would be dope. But, as it turns out, wow, look at that right there, too. This is filled with just a lot of cool history of that era. But the centerfold is this really nice... fortunately, the water damage didn't affect this Adam Hughes center spread. Emma Frost and Jean Grey. It's pretty sick. And I know this was eventually used as a Wizard magazine cover. Look at that new X-Men logo design there. That's so creative. Yeah, I really dug this Grant Morrison run on new X-Men, especially with the Frank Quitely issues. Usually, you know, I would have to say... yeah, that Grant Morrison run from like issue 114 of New X-Men up until 140. And then 151 to, I think it was like 154. The run with Mark Silvestri was pretty classic. So let me know what you thought of the reviews I've done in the past. Of the type of hauls I've been given, presentation, anything that you think I could do again or do better, I'd appreciate some feedback. Just want to be careful here, this really nice center spread of Miss Jean Grey and Emma Frost. Yeah, right. Right, you got the price guide in the back. Yeah. If you're also a collector of 9/11 comics, here's Wizard 133. This is actually something that I'm going to look for myself. Deadpool number one. Is that like 250? New Mutants, $104. Number 98, $7. The Ultimates gets Nyx. Interesting what they got there. Really cool. Class photo. just ordered this comic right here. This X-Men number 94 reprint. The Wizard World cover by Frank Quitely. I just ordered that for $15 plus another like $6 shipping. So 21 bucks for a very fine near mint copy of that. Got that coming on the way. Yeah, it's one of the few comics I've ordered in the past month. Yeah, I think I've done just like 'Okay, well, that's my haul. Thanks a lot for swinging by. Be that Sequential Geek. Thanks for checking out Sequential Hood. Y'all stay safe. Thanks for watching. Stay safe. Peace.